You're on camera one.
Take camera three, Mike.
I will get your script back to you in rapid fashion.
3, 2, 1.
Another call for increasing funding for transportation across the state, even as doubt grows in Annapolis about any new gas taxes. Good evening and welcome to Maryland Newsline. I'm Whitney Harris.
And I'm Annie Emberland. With the Monday night deadline looming, the General Assembly has a number of major bills still hanging in the balance. Among them, one to raise the gas tax.
Earlier in the session, Governor O'Malley proposed adding the state's sales tax to gasoline purchases. CNS-TV's Jamie Furzato has been following the latest developments in Annapolis. Jamie, I hear there's a chance that the sales tax for gas could be off the table.
Annie, Whitney, if it's not dead yet, it's on its last legs, and that word comes just as a new push was made in Annapolis today for the funding of some major transportation projects.
The original proposal called for phasing in the state's 6% sales tax over a three-year period for all gasoline purchases. But O'Malley isn't as confident in the proposal as he used to be. With only a few days left in the General Assembly session, the gas tax is running out of gas.
I always thought that the most unpopular thing is whenever you combine the word gas with the word tax.
But O'Malley's not giving up on finding a way to raise revenues for transportation and infrastructure projects. One option he's considering is to revisit the gas tax once prices fall below a certain level. The governor has also dropped hints about possibly raising the state's sales tax from 6 to 7 cents, putting that extra penny on the dollar towards transportation projects.
Both of those would raise approximately the same amount of revenue.
Opponents of the gas tax say that an additional tax at the pump is the wrong way to go and would only hurt consumers. So the big unknown is, will lawmakers be able to get it done with only a few days left in this session? Transportation advocates say they need the money now.
If it's dead, then we made yet another mistake.
A new report by TRIP, a national transportation research group, concludes that the most expensive project that should be pursued is the widening of I-95 in Prince George's and Montgomery counties. Estimated cost, $5.8 billion. But without the gas tax or an increase in the sales tax, the 20 projects included in the report would be stalled.
If I can save 10 or 15 minutes on a trip time, I will gladly pay 15 cents more a gallon for my fuel, period.
County Delegate Sam Aurora says there's talk of a special session. That means the governor could force the General Assembly to continue budget discussions after the session has officially ended, assuming the state's budget isn't passed by the final day. But O'Malley said that if he's going to force them to continue, they're running out of time, and the business of the legislature set to end Monday night at midnight. Reporting live from Annapolis, I'm Jamie Forzato, CNS-TV. Back to you guys.
Thanks, Jamie. Well, the election results from last night are in, and some Maryland politicians may soon find themselves out of office. Highlights include former Secret Service agent Daniel Bongio winning the Republican nomination for the U.S. Senate. Ben Cardin currently holds the position in the Senate, and he won with a landslide for the Democratic nomination, beating the next closest competitor, State Senator Anthony Muse, by nearly 50 percentage points. Cardin will face Bongio in the general election to try to keep his U.S. Senate seat. U.S. Representative Roscoe Bartlett will face some stiff competition in the general election as well. Financier John Delaney beat out State Senator Rob Gargiola for Maryland's 6th District Democratic primary, and with poor results for Bartlett yesterday, keeping his seat could be a challenge. State Senator Nancy Jacobs beat out her competitors to claim the Republican nomination for U.S. Congress. She'll face incumbent Democratic Dutch Ruppersberger. And as for presidential politics, Mitt Romney won Maryland's primary along with D.C. and Wisconsin, closing in on the delegate count and coming one step closer to the GOP presidential nomination.
Two hate crimes have the University of Maryland campus on alert tonight. Anti-Semitic messages defaced an elevator in an academic building in the first incident. In the other, a noose was discovered hanging in a renovation project. University President Wallace Lowe says both incidents are abhorrent. And he says although on-campus hate and bias crimes have dropped 85% over the past 9 years, even one hate crime is too many.
The University of Maryland student accused of threatening to go on a shooting rampage is back home tonight, but he won't be returning to campus anytime soon. Alexander Song was arrested last night and charged with misuse of email, disturbing the peace, and other offenses. The 19-year-old honor student allegedly made online threats to kill numerous people on the College Park campus last month. After a hearing today, Song was released on his own recognizance, but is barred from returning to the university campus.
They're tiny, but they carry huge germs. Maryland officials are warning people to be careful handling baby turtles and other young animals like chicks and rabbits. Five people are recovering after being hospitalized with salmonella. They bought underage baby turtles that were under 4 inches wide, too small to be legally sold. And yet another salmonella warning tonight. 8 Marylanders have been sickened after eating possibly contaminated sushi. Investigators aren't sure of the exact source of the salmonella outbreak, though.
Imagine being the parent of a child diagnosed with cancer and being told the medication that could save your child's life is not available. It's happening increasingly around the country, and it's the story of one Glen Burnie family. CNS-TV's Anna Sebastian says those families are counting on Maryland senators and congressmen to bring change that will eliminate a growing drug shortage problem.
Josh Williams is 24, in love, and with a dream of becoming an air traffic controller. But that dream is now on hold because of a battle Josh never anticipated.
I went from being a perfectly healthy young man to having cancer in less than 3 months.
He was diagnosed with osteosarcoma, a bone cancer, in February. That's when the battle began. But the life-saving medicine he needed was in short supply.
War America, the land of opportunity and plenty, where anyone can make themselves something. And all of a sudden, my future completely depends on this medication.
Josh is just one of a growing number of patients impacted by a nationwide shortage of potentially life-saving drugs. It's an issue that Maryland Senator Barbara Mikulski tackled at a special roundtable in Baltimore in an effort to find a way to correct the problem.
First question is, what's wrong with me? The next question is, can you help? Then the answer is, we think we can. And then the next question is, do we have enough?
The shortage of drugs is even felt at local privately owned pharmacies, like this one in Beltsville, right behind me.
2 days you have it, next day you cannot have it.
According to the Federal Drug Administration, 178 drugs were in short supply in 2010. In 2005, there were only 61. But will there be enough medicine for Josh next week is the question that his mother keeps asking.
Withholding medications, which hopefully won't happen, in my opinion, is a death sentence for my son. And we shouldn't have to live with that in this country.
In Baltimore, Anna Sebastian, CNS-TV.
Josh Williams is facing surgery in the next month and another 9 months of chemotherapy.
The mysterious Maryland Mega Millions ticket is still missing tonight. The alleged Maryland winner, Merlanda Wilson, and her attorney held a news conference earlier today in Baltimore, where he revealed the news that he has not seen the winning lottery ticket. Wilson claims that the ticket was hidden under the McDonald's where she works. There were 3 winning tickets sold for the record-breaking jackpot of $656 million, one in Kansas, one in Illinois, and one here in Maryland. The Maryland Lottery will hold a press conference tomorrow on the status of the alleged winning ticket, along with the claiming process and the state benefits from sales.
And next up on Maryland Newsline, Duck will tell you when and where NASA will be flying low tomorrow morning.
And meet the women who are rolling through their pain and suffering for the love of their sport.
Uncle called, speech all slurred, complaining his arm's numb. He called everyone. He even called my daughter Tierra, because, you know, she's got a year of nursing. Everyone thinks he needs to go to the doctor, including me. So he said, well, will you take me? I'm like, I'm on the road. He goes, I'll wait. Stroke's no joke. If you or someone you love have symptoms of stroke, don't wait. It may be too late. Dial 911. Time loss is brain loss.
This financial advisor is being accused of committing one of the largest investment frauds in the history of the United States.
I guess we're not going to Aspen. That's fine. You see, I like tennis balls. He likes insider trading. So he's going to jail and I'm going to a shelter. And no, they're not the same thing. Shelters are for good pets that want to be adopted. Jails are for criminals. I've done nothing. Uh-oh. Okay, I stole a cheeseburger once. I'm a dog.
Maryland prisoners could soon get a break on child support payments. The Senate passed a bill that allows convicts to ask the court to suspend their child supports. Opponents say it's unfair to children that criminals are allowed to avoid payment while in jail. Supporters say the mounting debt makes it less likely prisoners will pay regularly once released. The bill now heads to Governor O'Malley's desk.
An old building in Annapolis gets a new name today. The Jefferson Building on Francis Street, just half a block from the State House, was renamed the Wineland Building after Fred Wineland. He was the longest-serving Secretary of State in Maryland history from 1971 to 1983. Wineland was also a former Prince George's County delegate and senator. The 85-year-old World War II Navy vet was joined by his friends and family to celebrate the dedication.
Fred has tirelessly served the people of Maryland in a variety of capacities for more than 40 years. Any of you that are biblical scholars know that 40 years is always indicative of a long time. And throughout those 40 years, including as our state's longest serving Secretary of State, our longest serving commissioner on the Maryland Port Commission, where he played a significant role in making our port truly world class, he distinguished himself by being a world-class Marylander.
The Jefferson Building was originally named for the building contractor's grandson.
Roller derby is a unique and physically demanding sport. The risk of injury is high, and anyone trying out for the league is required to have health insurance. But despite the risk, the girls are as passionate as ever about the sport, as are the fans. Tonight, in the second part of my special report, I'll tell you about some of those injuries and some of the fans. Injuries are common in roller derby.
I've broken a rib, I've torn my hamstring, and I've had a concussion.
Like, I've thrown out my back, I've torn my meniscus.
And we all have the bruises and the lumps and all that kind of cool stuff.
So, safety is key, and skaters wear protective gear from head to toe.
Gaskets, knee pads, elbow pads, wrist pads, helmet, skates, and mouth guard.
It's not for show. We're not out there throwing punches just to throw punches because it's illegal. It's real. It's dirty, just like football and basketball.
Derby allows the women to step beyond expectations.
Women are supposed to be prim and proper and taking care of the home. You don't see a lot of girls just randomly hitting people. They need to get their aggression out somehow.
Empowering women, a goal of the league, is echoed by the skaters.
I wish every female could experience derby just once.
And it's a sport where all women stand a chance.
From the tiniest, fastest jammer to the biggest, toughest blocker, you know, all kinds of women are doing derby and doing it really well.
Unlike many sports, the DC Roller Girls is a nonprofit run by the skaters for the skaters, from fundraising to volunteer work.
You've got, you know, 80 really busy women who are trying to juggle skating with the rest of their lives.
Often spending over 20 hours a week on derby, it's almost a part-time job.
People wouldn't do that if they didn't love it. And it's just really, derby saves your soul.
And the fans come out because they love it too.
We wish we were cool enough to be on the team, but...
And we like to come here and talk about joining the team, and it gives us something to keep going.
It's action, it's, you know, it's an independent sports league, it's a lot of fun.
You get to beat someone up without any penalty. Well, I mean, there are penalties, but no jail time.
The girls are a lot of fun to watch, and it's amazing some of the things they do on roller skates that I don't think I could do without them on.
Sherman and Brantner are also gearing up for their own move into the spotlight when they get drafted to a team.
You're going to see me this year on a team. That's my goal.
But drafted or not, one thing is certain for the skaters. Derby is here to stay.
There's so many things that you can take from it that make your life better.
Thank you, Pat, for telling me what you did. I forgot it.
See roller girls will hold their next doubleheader at the DC Armory on April 14th. For more information on the league, you can visit their website at dcrollergirls.com.
And don't be frightened by those low-flying jets tomorrow morning. It's just NASA taking pictures. Two T-38 training jets will just about skim the treetops around 1,500 feet above D.C. from 9:30 to 11 a.m. NASA says the flights are to capture photogenic imagery and should be fairly unobtrusive.
Some history-making cameras are being retired right here in D.C. IMAX is donating the very first cameras used aboard the space shuttle to the Smithsonian's Air and Space Museum. Almost 100 astronauts used the 70mm cameras to shoot giant screen images of Earth and life in zero gravity for a half dozen IMAX films. The camera will soon become part of the Smithsonian's permanent collection.
And there's much more still ahead tonight on Maryland Newsline.
Lizzie Horn joins us with a look at sports tonight.
Next up in sports, one of the best teams at Maryland is also one of the least supported. The softball team has had a winning record for over 10 years, but students don't seem to know. More on softball when we come back.
I knew it! Oh, this isn't good. I was a gift from him to her. I'm going to the animal shelter, which isn't necessarily bad. I just hate the stigma associated with shelter pets. People will think I bite or that I spray everywhere. They're the ones with problems. I'm totally fine. Adopt me, you'll see. I'm gonna go pack.
I can't even believe you! And she has a mustache!
Howard University just suspended all of its athletic teams for what appears to be a violation of NCAA rules. University spokeswoman Carrie Ann Hamilton says the suspension was self-imposed and will last until the university completes a review. The university has not announced the violations under investigation. One student athlete says the situation needs to serve as a learning experience for both the athletes and the department. The softball team might have one of the best records at the University of Maryland, but most students at the school don't even know where the field is. I headed over to the Robert E. Taylor Stadium to see why the team hasn't been getting the support it's been looking for. The softball team might be one of the best at Maryland, but most students have no idea.
I feel like softball is always kind of on the back burner no matter what. I don't know why. I think a lot of people underestimate. I think they think of us lobbing a softball like it's a watermelon.
Despite its consistent winning record, the softball team often sees empty stands. Even after the team's run in the NCAA regionals the past 2 years, the team isn't getting the recognition it's been hoping for. Laura Watton, coached since 2006, says she is hoping that soon that will all change.
You know, I really want to be able to build a following and have the energy that programs like men's soccer has. You know, their games are just crazy. They've got great fans and very loyal fans and very committed, and I'd like to have, be able to build that here.
Now, midway through the season, the team is undefeated at home and looking for another chance to win at regionals.
Despite the fact that the stands might not be as full as the players are hoping, they do say that the fans that do come mean the world to them.
The players also say that it is the support of senior Kathy McLaughlin that keeps them inspired, regardless of acknowledgement.
I would just love to have crowds at every game. I would love to win. I would love to, be a top 25, top 10 team.
But McLaughlin hopes, too, that one day the school will give them more credit.
I mean, I wish that we could definitely get a lot more people here. I mean, we've been to other places. We went to Alabama this year, and, it was packed down there. They have, season tickets sold out. I wish that we could, get a nice crowd here.
One loyal fan is convinced that if students come out, they'll get hooked.
But, man, once they come to one game, I think they see how exciting it is. And they'll come back, and they'll come back again, and back again. And if the girls continue to win and perform like they've been doing, I think they'll get there soon, someday.
Go! The softball team plays a doubleheader against George Mason University tonight at 5-7. The Washington Nationals kick off their 2012 season tomorrow after a very interesting preseason. The team started spring training with a new set of expectations and with the appearance of an emergent team. With the talent of Steven Strasburg, Bryce Harper, and Ryan Zimmerman, the Nats are shaping up to be a top playoff choice. Second baseman Danny Espinosa thinks the Nats have the chance to win a lot of ball games this year. The Nats take on the Chicago Cubs at Wrigley Field at 2:20 p.m. Two college baseball teams found a different way to pass the time during a rain delay, with a dance-off. Players from the University of Mississippi and the University of Southern Mississippi were set to play when it started pouring, so the teams decided to battle it out with some theater. Ole Miss coach Cliff Godwin says the teams made the most of the delay and that the crowd loved it. The game was rescheduled for later this season.
Thanks, Lizzie. Next, we'll take you to explore a special side of divination.
That, interestingly enough, has men donning lipstick. That's next on Maryland Newsline.
Life's funny. I never thought I'd end up at a shelter. But then again, neither did you. Life's funny.
This, ready, ready.
Oh, come on, Randy. Animal shelter, here I come. And no, I'm not crazy or emotionally damaged. That's a stereotype. I just belong to a total loser. I'm a good dog. So if you want a pet, adopt. And if you see Randy, tell him he dropped his wallet.
Anna Snodgrass would be the first one to tell you that palm reading isn't the coolest reading on the block any longer. And she's been doing it for more than 3 decades.
But it's something that makes people laugh, wear lipstick, and give her an excuse to buy all lip swag. Anna Sebastian has the story.
It isn't theater or drag, but it's a practice where even men put on lipstick.
I've never put lipstick on in my whole life.
Anna Snodgrass, or as her stage name would have it, Ariana Lightning Storm, is a musician, a palm reader, and one of the 6 people in the country in business of lip print reading.
There's a big hug pucker. This is a teddy bear hugger here. And
of course, Snodgrass, who's been in the business about 18 months now, is certified by Jillie Eddy, a Washington State woman who invented the practice. She's the only certified lipsologist on the East Coast. Here is how it works. You pick the color, apply the lipstick, and kiss the card.
It's entertaining. It's not about making someone go any particular direction in life, you know. It's just about helping people to see something in themselves, and, you know, that's it. You care about what kind of an impression you make, so that's very important to you. Would you say that's true?
Actually, it's right on the money.
But not so much for psychologist Thomas Carlson, who says people cling to the parts of the reading that are correct.
It's not so bad when they get something wrong. It's when they get something right that they're really impressed.
To see for myself, I've handed her 8 sheets of paper with 8 different lip prints for Capital News Service staff. Out of those 8 mysterious prints, 1 was mine. Number 3.
Okay, on to 3. They're really handling their whatever stress that they're going through pretty well. At home.
And just like with any other reading, she offers 1 last piece of advice.
Seeds of change. Just do it.
In the movie, Anna Sebastian, CNS TV.
Snodgrass charges $350 for 2 hours at parties and just $2 to $2.50 for individual clients. So I know if I ever get my lips red, I'm going to do it individually. Did you get yours done?
I actually did. Apparently, I'm very picky, but I'm also a very caring person.
I can see that. I can definitely see that.
That's Maryland Newsline for tonight. I'm Annie Emberlin. Thanks for joining us. You can find out more about the stories presented here by going to our website, cnsmaryland.org.
And I'm Whitney Harris. Don't forget to check out our CNS Facebook page as well. You can find us at Maryland Capital News. Maryland Capital News Service. Have a good weekend, and we'll see you back here next week.
You should get yours red.
Actually, we'll see you here tomorrow.